Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
Yeah, so I've always wanted to speak to a clinical psychologist because I'm really interested and fascinated with human nature and how human behave and, you know, the way they act. And so I'm really happy that I'm finally having my first episode with a clinical psychologist.
Good.
Yeah, thank you for taking your time.
Pleasure.
I've been reading The Laws of Human Nature. It's a book by Robert Greene. And I think my main takeaway has been how our childhood experiences influence the type of adults we become.
Sure.
Right? Especially the experience that we have with our parents. So how deep does the experience that kids get with their parents, either mental, physical, or emotional, affect them in the future?
Now, it's extremely influential on how it shapes their vision of themselves, of the world, how it shapes their experience with everything growing up. So that's also why, not only in the psychological field, but we even say that the first years of a child's life are very key. Even if we talk about just simply the nutrition, like everything that you have in terms of nutrition, but also care, will affect how your core is going to form itself and then build up later on.
And how does it affect it? Like, is it how our brain is wired, or like how does that work?
It works in a sense that, let me try to find a simple way of talking about it, but a child, when it comes to world, is not only, it's actually feeling a lot of things. It's feeling everything. It feels sensations of content. It feels the sensations of even discontent, of pain, of hunger, of, and when our job as caretakers is trying to see the cues and see how we can provide, you know, what the child needs in terms of comfort and making the child feel safe. When it grows up in that environment of feeling safe and feeling nurtured, it's going to even build a perception of, you know, I'm here in a safe space, even as a baby and while growing up as well. So when it grows up and it doesn't have those things, you might actually, not only is it going to feel like unsafe and feel like it's not equipped to deal with things outside of themselves, but in a twisted way, children are also very self-centered. So what also usually happens is they start blaming themselves or even feeling guilty for what they feel is happening to them. So even their perception of themselves as being flawed, as being weak, as being unable to cope with the environment, you know, in just simple environment, it's going to build their self-image and their image of interaction with the world as well.
And it fascinates me how many people don't understand the relationship between their childhood experiences and who they have become. And I don't know where the gap is in that.
Maybe because there's been this idea that children are not intelligent enough, I guess, or that we only value intelligence at an adult form. That if you, the children of a one-year-old or two-year-old, oh, they're going to forget, or they don't know what's happening, or, you know, they're running all the time, and they're not very cognizant of what's happening. But actually, children absorb so much of the energy around them, of the tension that the parents might feel. You know, babies, if they feel like the mom is tense, even if they're just, you know, a couple of days old, they will feel the tension as well. They'll absorb it, and they'll also start crying much more if they feel that the mom is relaxed and at ease, you know, even in their bellies, you know, when the mom is carrying the child in her belly, but she feels tense or she's stressed, there's a stress also that is being felt by the baby inside, you know, by the stress hormones or even, you know, by the tension. So the baby also feels that. It also going to affect the way it's going to be able to build or structure its brain already inside of the mom's belly.
I like the fact that you have touched a bit about, you know, kids being able to learn mm-hmm. a lot when they're young. Because mm-hmm. I think, I don't remember where I read this, but it said something like if a kid learns something when they're 4 years old, they'll pretty much remember it their whole life.
Mm.
Yeah. Parents should know that, right? Parents should know that the formative years, they're probably the most important years of someone's lives.
Yes.
And, you know, they can't just ignore them and pretend like they don't understand anything or they don't understand what's going on.
It's the best investment you can make in a child's life. It's really to give the best that you can in terms of attention, in terms of love, in terms of care, in terms of play with a child, because a child grows while playing, while feeling safe, while feeling loved. And this is why in now a couple of countries, even in nursery schools, they do not focus anymore on, you know, making sure that the child is able to recite such and such a thing, but they're really more focusing on the capacity of the child to create bonds with other friends, to feel good, you know, inside them, in the relationship with friends and family, and because that's really important in how the child is going to grow. And also in terms of, if you make a relationship with an adult, you know, I don't know if you feel stressed, as an adult and you're in class, you're not going to be able to focus much. But if you feel good and, you know, within, and you feel at ease and you have friends, and you're going to be able to open up. So really, also something that people are not really aware of is, you know, there's the emotional brain, builds and develops before the, you know, all the cognitive or the, you know, brain, if I can oversimplify it. So it's really important to address, you know, the sense of safety and the sense of care and love. And it's not something that a school or teacher is aware of. And I would say there's someone who's very well known and called Gabor Maté, and who also stresses that a lot in terms of the importance of making sure that when you have a child in a class or somewhere else, that they feel like they're safe, they're loved, because that is going to be first and foremost if you want them to learn better and to grow up into an adult that is stable and harmonized. They first need to feel that harmony within themselves.
Also, it sounds like that's most important than actually what they're going to be learning in class.
Yes, it comes first. But, you know, we all have in mind that teacher that we really loved. And because they were able to connect with us. And yeah. Because of that, we really loved the content. It was not the other way around. Mm. You might come into a class where you have, okay, you wanted that content, but do you feel like there's no connection, or the person is really not focused or not really attentive to, you know, the public. But so the connection is really key.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, I agree with you. There are times that, I mean, so I mean, I'm also guilty of that, right? I also did physics simply because I loved the teacher. Mm-hmm. And then later I realized, I shouldn't be doing physics, but I just did it because I love the teacher.
but this is how it should be.
Yeah, no, absolutely, absolutely. I mean, I think teaching should be more than just delivering content. It should actually be more about connecting with the person and understanding them and the person. So you find the best ways that works for them and, you know, the best ways to teach them too.
Mm-hmm. And I think you can make that, you know, it's easier for you as an adult if you don't like the person to really differentiate one and the other. But as a child, you actually don't.
Yeah,
you know, the connection is key. That's what is the main thing.
So how does our exposure to early adversity affect us? Like, how deep does it run, right? Because you'll hear, I mean, I have friends who have actually gone through, you know, childhood abuse, right? Mm. And then right now, like, they're adults, and if they see someone who reminds them of the person who abused them, they'll instantly hate them, mm-hmm. even if they haven't done anything bad to them. So it's mm-hmm. like, how early does, you know, exposure to early adversity affect growing minds and bodies?
Mm. You know, there's even a direct correlation between, you know, the trauma you might have experienced in childhood and illnesses you might be prone to later on as an adult, just because in terms of the stress factors also, it's going to affect the capacity of your own body to fight back. There's some studies that are around about that. So there's a direct correlation in terms of also, also in terms of, for example, even in terms of asthma in children, the fact that children who live in a household where there's a lot of stress, or the parents are there's a lot of stress among the parents, for example, children are going to be more likely to develop those kind of asthma, for example, just because it's a reduction of your stress level, immune system, related to the chronic stress that a child goes through. And this is true also as an adult. If you go through an event that is continuously stressful for you, it's going to affect your body's capacity to withstand some challenges. So these direct correlation are, you know, well shown by studies as well. But in terms of what you were just saying about triggers, right? Let's say something happens to a child and it hasn't been addressed. And usually, you know, in terms of trauma, it's not the event itself. It's somehow the response to the event. And usually, when you were a child, maybe the fact that you were left alone with that response. So there's no one who helped you make sense of it, or even provided some kind of support, or, you know, so that you could weed out, you know, maybe the sense of guilt or shame or that might have been associated to it, or the sense of unsafety. So you something happens to you. It's not the event itself, but how you interpret the event and how maybe you felt you were alone with that event and dealing with it. And the trauma response, in a way, if the person is afraid of something that happened, similar to something that happened to it, if you think about it, it's a normal way it's like to ring the alarm. The body or the brain is ringing the alarm saying, pay attention. This is something that was very similar to something that happened to you before. Pay attention. It might be dangerous to you now. So in a way, it's not flawed. Actually, it's the right response if you think about it, so that it keeps you safe, right? But when you realize that actually it has nothing to do with, you know, to the safety in a broader sense, and you realize, I'm just, brings me back to something else, then it would be useful to go and try to find out ways to weed out and to understand where that response comes from, because there's a reason. And the reason is not that you're crazy. It's just, it's a normal reason, because there's an alarm that was put into your brain and your body about something that happened to you that you felt was dangerous to you at the time.
So you spoke about the power of the mind, right? And how sometimes that, you know, childhood experiences will make us less immune to fight diseases, mm-hmm. simply because of what you have gone through and maybe the way they're addressed. Mm-hmm. And also, most of the times when you're a kid, for example, if you're sexually harassed, right? And then you tell your parents, most of the time they don't believe you, right? Mm-hmm. They think you're just making it up. Mm-hmm. And I think that's where the whole point of, you know, it's how you deal with it that affects you more than actually what happened. So the response to it. And speaking about the power of the mind, have you read Viktor Frankl's Man's Search for Meaning? It's a book that speaks about his experiences mm-hmm. in the concentration camps, right? Mm. And he was a psychiatrist.
Mm.
And so he shared his experience saying that most of the times it's not the internal events that happen.
Mm.
Let me read to you what he said. Right. So he said, even though conditions such as lack of sleep, insufficient food, and various mental stresses may suggest that inmates were bound to react in certain ways, in the final analysis, it becomes clear that the sort of person the prisoner became was the result of an inner decision and not the result of the camp influences alone. Mm. So I think in a way he's also touching the power of mind, and, you know, because there are people who are like, you know what, I'm just waiting to die, right? So in a way also it lowers their immune system, and, you know, they're prone to getting sick and diseases and stuff like that. And so he analyzed and said that most of the people who made it out were the ones who are like, you know what, one day I'm gonna, so there are people who had something to look forward to, right? They're like, probably one day I'm gonna go out and meet my family or meet my wife or meet my kids. And for him, he was like, he would vision himself in front of a university lecture, right? And it's something that he was passionate about, because in the book he also covers the things that he believes gives someone's life meaning, and one of it was work and the other one was relationship. So most of those people who believed that in the near future they're gonna see their loved ones or they're gonna do the work that they love doing, then they had more willingness to survive, and so they were it was easy for them to actually fight diseases and harsh conditions that they're exposed to in the camp.
I would agree, I think, with most of it. It's on the word decision. I think linking it back to what you were saying about childhood experience, it might be just on how you experience the world before. If you grew up with that sense of meaning or the sense of transmission or the sense of I need, it doesn't stop with me. Or if you grew up, you know, that sense of meaning doesn't mean that it's a decision that you can just switch on. I think he might have been very fortunate to also have grown up in a family that was loving and caring and that gave him, you know, that strong basis of looking forward to, or of the world having different possibilities or possibility of changes and things like that. Whereas if, for example, a child who grew up in already a very traumatic environment might have lost a lot of hope, and then finding himself or herself in that situation might have said, okay, it's just a confirmation of, and what am I looking forward to in the future anyway? So the thing of the decision, I would just put a, just to be mindful that it's not as easy as just making a decision. It might be just, you know, the entire, your background, if you were fortunate enough to have gone that positive background that built you up,
I don't know if, you know, him seeing life that way or, you know, viewing those things to be the things that give someone meaning, I don't know if he got that from the family or from his childhood experiences, but I agree with you, and I agree with what you're saying. Mm-hmm. And so I have a friend, right, who was sexually abused, and it's something that he still suffers to date, right? It's something that every time he remembers, he would actually cry speaking about it.
Yeah.
Right? So let's assume you have such a person walk into your room. How do you start treating them?
You listen. I think maybe what brings him to the room is what you just mentioned before. Maybe he wasn't heard before, or his feelings weren't validated, or he tried to push that away, lots of reasons, or he felt ashamed. Or she, I don't know if you said he or she.
Yeah, it's a him.
So, or he felt like it was his fault. And now maybe he reaches a time or an age where he's able to get some clarity on some things, and he wants to understand it better. What is coming from him? What is coming from outside? So these might be different types of questions that you want to hear with him and to see with him.
Hey, but doesn't it scare you in the fact that most of the times all you need to do is just sit down and listen to them, and most of the parents usually neglect that, and it creates all this suffering to a person's life?
We don't just sit down and listen.
I mean, I know you do more than that, but I mean, I think the fact that just simply listening could help them a great deal to navigate through the whole experience.
It's part of it, but it's a big part of it. And it's listening without drowning, right? Sometimes I
well, the way we all have our own ways of seeing our work, but sometimes I feel like people that are coming here are in their own trenches. They're fighting their own wars, and they're coming and they're telling you about it. And basically, sometimes you just hear a voice, and you want, and there's kind of shouting from their own trenches, and your job is to go and look out for them, look for them. And then once you're able to see each other and to see how you can pull them out together out of that trench. So it's not only just listening, seeing where they are now for the moment. And is there a way out? What would the way out look like for them? What is needed for them to feel safe? For them to feel cared, for them to feel valued. And it's not that easy. But aren't we afraid? We need to feel. I mean, if you don't feel, then you won't be able to hear the voices. You won't be able to locate the person in those trenches. You need to try to see where they are. But it doesn't mean that you are in the trenches. You're just outside, but you're there to try to find them. And yeah, this is how I see it.
I know that. I'll just say I know that. But I think that most of the times when you're listening to them, you're trying to be there for them. But at the same time, you're also trying to detach yourself from the situation, right? In a way that you don't also burden yourself with everything that they're going, such that it becomes hard to handle. Like, do you get such, you know, situations where you're sitting down with someone and you're having a conversation with them, and then it burdens you so much such that you also feel like it's part of your own experience?
I mean, it's also part of the work to also acknowledge it. Let's say, for example, someone comes to me and talks about their child, and something terrible happens to their child, and they're the same age as mine, for example. And I would feel extremely, you know, I would be extra touched, not only because I can understand what it means to be a parent, or I can understand what it means to be vulnerable at that age. Where the professional is we're not going to start crying for our own experience. We're there for the person, right? And this is where it's more helpful to be. I mean, let me try to re-explain. It's normal to feel a specific way if we feel like there's a specific connection with the person coming in, but it's also part of the work to recognize that, so that you're not blurred by your own experience. Let's say, for example, you went through a divorce and somebody comes to you with their own divorce problem. You're not going to start thinking, this is how I should be doing. You know, you should be doing this and say that. No, that's not the point. The point is to help the person find their own clarity with specific questions. But it's not you to start putting values and opinions and your own experience. Actually, this is where the work comes, as you know, you come as a person who's there to help you find clarity for yourself without specifically, you know, pointing you in a specific direction based on your own experience. I don't know if it makes sense. But it's normal to feel it like that. But the training helps you, you know, put things in their place.
Does it ever get overwhelming?
In what way?
In a way that you hear so many people sharing their stories, and most of the times, obviously, they're not good stories, they're not good experiences, right? Are there times that you feel like this is a lot, actually, like these are lots of emotions?
Of course, but at the same time, I'm happy for the person to have come, because once you come, I feel like there's hope. At least there's some type of hope. Doesn't mean that you need to come here to have hope. There's other avenues. But once the person is ready to seek help for a problem that they feel overwhelmed by, then I feel like, okay, that's the right step forward. Let's work on this then.
Yeah, I mean, I suppose it must also be rewarding for you being able to just help them through that process.
You know, it's not something that is done alone. So it's always a collaborative work. It's work. It's work for someone to come and face their demons. It's work. It's painful. So I would say the biggest work is really the person coming in. Like, for example, the friend that you mentioned, if they had to come in, it's something that is going to be painful for them at one point. And so I wouldn't say I'm doing the work. The person is doing the work. Are you just accompanying them?
Yeah, the person is doing the work and you're just accompanying them.
Once people come in, I feel like there's hope.
Mm.
And in that sense, hope lifts the overwhelming part of it.
Oh, okay.
And where there is like trying to help solve a puzzle, I would say. Many times is how I see it. And also almost like, the best possible, I would say, lawyer, but in a way, like, you know, the lawyer is supposed to look out for your best interest. And once people come in, there's always, because they come in, there's hope, there's the desire to work on something, there's the acknowledgement, these are so many important part of finding a new way of dealing with something that might have been overwhelming until now.
What's usually the tipping point? Right. So, for example, let's say if someone has had, was sexually abused, right? What's the tipping point that makes them think, you know what? Now I need help. Now I need to go and see a professional to help me.
I think it's so personal. I think to everyone. But I think maybe the tipping point is when they reach, it can be for everyone, and any type of challenge is when they reach to a point where they realize that they cannot function the way they would like to function, and everything that else that they've tried is failing. Usually that's when people come in and say, you know, I've tried so many things and it's not working, or I tried this and this and that, but I feel like it doesn't work for me anymore. And, or I realize now this way, and it's all coming back to me, and I don't know how to handle this, so that, it's in a way that doesn't hurt me or other people around me. So these can be some of the reasons why people come in.
Have you ever experienced burnout? Like, have you ever worked and, you know, you went like, you know, I think I need a break. I just don't think I can do it anymore.
Yeah. Yes, I think so. Yes. But not in this field.
In what other fields, if you don't mind sharing?
In management. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
What causes burnout? Right, I mean, and because sometimes, you know, someone could go like, you know what, I'm actually working really hard.
Mm.
I mean, and it's like, well, are you working hard and or are you productive? Because you might be working hard, but you're not really productive, right? Mm. And so, you know, what's the tipping point for also someone saying, you know what, I need a break.
Yeah,
I'm burnt out.
Mm. I think. Okay, first of all, I think the word burnout has an interesting origin. It was a psychologist who noted that amongst a specific set of professionals, nurses and doctors, at one point he noted that they were burning out all the resources. They were lacking at one point motivation to do their work, and they were so fatigued. And he noticed that it was kind of the dark side of self-sacrifice, because before that, those people would give themselves so much, to their work and not take care of themselves, really put their own needs aside. So what burnout, now we know that it can be, you know, not only for them, but for any type of profession or even any type of care. It's related to a chronic source of stress. So it's not one stress. It's not something that happens to you and you have to deliver something and one time and then for the rest of the time, you're okay. It's like a constant or a chronic level of stress, with a requirement of delivering certain things, criteria or ultimatums or deadlines that are really short and required a lot of resources from you. And at one point, it becomes too much, because if you're all constantly on that level of stress, at one point, you know, there's that fatigue.
And a breakdown.
And then that's the breakdown, because your needs at one point come up. It might be, and it might come up at certain times, more than others. It might be related to something that happens in your own family, for example, and you realize, oh, I can't be here and there at the same time. I need to choose, but... Okay. That added level of stress is also contributing to my mental well-being, of feeling I'm imbalanced. So when you're saying, I need to take a break, actually, when we talk about burnout, we need to think about it as a system. It's part of a systematic, chronic, the way of the work is being handled or dispatched. So just taking a break, going on vacation for a month or two and then coming back to that constant level of stress wouldn't help out much, because you would then go back to that, you know, level of fatigue. The best way would be to have that discussion or to really rethink on, you know, what are your needs and what is sustainable in terms of providing a product. Do you need help? And this is something that burnout usually comes among people who are very high achievers, very ambitious, who want to prove themselves, the newcomers, and they don't want to ask for help. They want to prove, to say, you know, I can do it all. Yes, bring it on. But at one point, it doesn't help. And it's actually a disfavor to the system to put yourself on that constant level of stress, because at one point, you might break, and then the system might lose you. Instead of finding a way that is more harmonious and taking into account everyone's resources and capacity.
So is there a type of lifestyle that we can live to avoid burnout, or is it bound to happen? Like, for example, let's say, you know, assume you work 8 hours and then, you know, get 8 hours of rest, and then, I don't know, however you choose to spend the rest of the time. But then is there a balanced type of lifestyle that someone can live to avoid having burnouts? Or, like, you know, are we born to always experience burnout no matter the type of lifestyle that we live?
No, I don't think you're bound to experience burnout. I think it shouldn't be there. I think it's being aware of what your needs are. And also, the needs are very different from one person to another. If you have that time to spend on work, and for you, you know, it's okay, then it's okay. But let's say, for example, you're a parent of three, and at one point you need to go and get your children, and maybe you have a child who doesn't sleep the night, then, you know, you'll have a certain level of resources that is available to you to do certain tasks. And it would be unfair for companies to just say, okay, I'm just going to work with single people or single men, because they are the one with that time. We're going to leave everyone else, because then you would also deprive yourself of other type of diverse input and contribution that could make your company stronger and more innovative. And actually, when you see companies that are thriving, these are the companies that take that balance, harmony of their employees into consideration. And it's really, really important to do that.
So,
sorry, just to continue to that, I think one of the important things to take into consideration is not only as an employee, but also as the heads of companies, to also give the right example. Take those days off. Don't send messages at 7 p.m., 8 p.m. You don't expect your colleagues to work over weekend or continuously over the weekend. Realize, you know, that there needs to be a break. Needs to be something. We're not just work, we're not just robots. So burnout should not be a fatality. It shouldn't, specifically if we're now more and more aware of the importance of mental health and mental, the balance. It's really important if we want to have this, to stay on this course for a long time.
Work-life balance, how do you define it?
I think just balance, balance realizing, you know, what are the things that are important to you, what are the things that can help you provide, can give you some strength and energy. So it's the capacity to see how to manage your life in a way that has meaning for you, that has joy for you, that has some form of happiness, something of fulfillment. That is, you know, usually when you're in balance, these are the pointers that are going to come up. When you feel dissatisfied, or constantly stressed, unhappy, and usually these are also pointers of there's an imbalance somewhere, and where the imbalance is, then you can look at, you know, when you open your eyes and start analyzing more. Okay, what is happening? What am I doing in my day? During my day, where does this stress come out? So the balance, you know, there's pointers. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Most college students nowadays are missing that, right? Mm-hmm. The ability to say, you know, these are the things I want to do and these are the things I'm going to be doing. And, you know, these are the things I want to focus on, right? And I've been hearing from a lot of students that, you know, I'm experiencing burnout. I think I need to take a break. And it seems like it's becoming a pandemic in a way. Right? Yeah. Such that, you know, everyone is saying the same things. Mm-hmm. And I mean, how many people are actually experiencing burnout and how many people think that they're experiencing it or they just need a break? Probably they haven't been getting enough hours of sleep or they're not eating well.
Yeah. So, yeah, I think maybe when you clarify what they mean by burnout, is it that they're just tired today or is it a constant sense of fatigue that they can't shake? And they feel so demotivated or they start disengaging themselves from work and they may be suffering now from presenteeism. They might be there, but they're not there. So you might even be at work, but really not being able to produce anything. So these would be, signs of burnout. But if you feel like really stressed and tired, it might be signs of, you know, maybe you might feel that you're going to go into burnout. And that's also important to note. Whatever it is, there's an alarm that's ringing and that they should take into consideration.
It has become common hearing students complain that they're tired.
Yeah.
Right? Like most of them, almost everyone, they'll just be like, you know, I'm tired. I'm tired every day. Okay. I need to rest. And I'm like, what makes them tired in the first place, right? I mean, are they thinking about the future that, you know, stresses them out? Mm-hmm. Or, you know, the fact that, you know, they know that, you know, after here, I'm going to graduate college and then I don't know what I'm going to do next. I don't know where I'm going to go next, right? Because from primary, you know, after primary, you go to secondary and then secondary to high school and then high school to college. And then it's like, now, cool, after college, where do I go next?
Yeah.
Right? Because I think you're also transforming and, you know, moving to a different part of life. You're not a student anymore.
Mm.
Well, unless you want to pursue further studies. But then maybe such things also stresses them out. And it's like, I mean, how do they solve these things, right? Like, how do they, you know, because you said these are the stressors, right? And you know, just getting enough hours of sleep probably wouldn't help you because you're still stressed about it, you're still thinking about it.
So in that case, as you mentioned, it might be something else. As you say, it might be signs of anxiety or even depression related to a future that they feel is hopeless. And it might bring those kind of sense of being weighed down and feeling some form of despair. But again, I think it's important to notice that and not to see it, to have an opportunity or platform to realize where it comes from. As you said, you now listed a couple of options. You know, maybe they're thinking about the future and then realizing, okay, they're afraid of the outcomes. How are they going to deal with, what happens next? And And so this feeling is almost also again like an alarm, like from the there's a danger coming up, and I don't know how to deal with it. The danger then would be to stay stuck in it, to feel like I won't move, instead of reaching out to either a professional or somewhere else, or even a student counselor or a student body that can help you weed out, you know, that feeling. Is there for a reason, but maybe let's find how we can find solutions for that reason.
Is it like a constant cycle in a way that does everyone who gets to university when they're about to graduate and figure out like, you know what, I think I'm going to be on my own.
Yeah.
Like, do they start getting depressed like for certain people?
No, it's very common. It's very, very common and rightly so. There's the unknown. Let's say, for example,
the fear of the unknown.
What happens next? Am I able to find work? The expectations or the pressures? How am I going to deal with that? Or so much was given to me, and now am I a failure because I don't have? You know, I should have this and that,
and
expectation, feeling guilty and feeling ashamed. Those are guilt, shame can be also be. Or uncertain, what next? What are the others thinking? What are my parents thinking? I should make my parents proud. All those things, all those questions come up like old demons coming up. And so how do you deal with that? So how do you deal with that? How do you deal with the ideas, and how do you deal with the actions? How do you help mitigate the anxiety and the feeling of depression related to the ideas and to a form of reality? But it's not, you know, it's not the end. It's like the chapter doesn't end there. You have the entire life to solve it.
For our listeners out there, and you know, who will probably be having these questions and they're going through this stage, it's probably making them depressed. I mean, what's your advice on them? Like, what are the things that they can start maybe doing that would help them, you know, go through this stage without a lot of challenges?
First of all, realizing that they're not alone. Then it also, it's very common and it's very normal to have those questions at the end of the studies. And because these questions have been around for so long, there are also people who have answers or options to these questions that you're asking yourself. I would start with the available resources on campus, and maybe reach out to the student bodies or the student counselors or even the teachers, and to ask those questions, because these are legitimate questions. Don't feel like these are questions that are shameful. Not at all. Those are really important questions to have as well. And start having those conversations even with your friends. But if you feel like they're not having answers, then look for other people with possible answers, with possible options as well. If you feel like it's becoming too overwhelming, then maybe also consider seeing a professional to help you weed out, you know. Those thoughts.
And is there a way for someone to know, you know what, I'm just trying to think about my future and I'm trying to plan about my future, and then say, you know what, this is actually pressing me, I'm overdoing it, right?
Yeah.
Like, are there pointers that could tell you like, well, it's okay, you know, you're just worried about the future, and it's okay to be worried about the future, it's okay to try and think about it right now and maybe try and plan of it, and you know, or it's like, well, I think I'm overdoing this, I think this is stressing me out, and I think it's gonna get me depression.
Yeah. I mean, there's no wrong time to ask for help. I mean, there's no wrong time to ask for input. If you're afraid of the word help, try input. You know, even if people coming to our offices who are okay, but who just want to address something, we're happy to have them in. It's even easier to work with people who are good and who have, you know, things that they want to sort out, than with people who have reached really
chronic stage
of a very low level. So don't feel embarrassed. If you're asking input from anyone, it's, I think, the best way to go about it. Why not? If you have that opportunity, go for it.
If you have that opportunity, then go for it, because there are some who really don't have that opportunity and they need the...
And if you don't, then maybe you have access to internet. Maybe you have access to books. To teachers, these are also great resources.
Yeah, no, they are big time. They are. When you're a
maybe
student,
you have access to podcasts.
Absolutely. And now you have access to a clinical psychologist. Free of charge. Mm-hmm. Did you also experience such feelings when you're also a student back then?
Of course. I think these are feelings that are, as we're human, we go through, you know, ups and downs. And specifically when we're students and we're put in environments that are unfamiliar to us, we're becoming adults, we're becoming independent, away from home, away from families, with our dreams, with our own expectations from ourselves. And we're confronted with many things that might not fit with our initial thoughts, but at the same time that are broadening our universe and way of thinking. So I think looking back, the best advice I would give myself would to try to find people you trust and ask them for that input. And that having those questions inside of you doesn't mean that you're less. Actually, it means that you're on a quest and you're trying to find answers. And aren't we all?
Yeah. And perhaps we probably should have, you know, better resources to help people who are going through that stage. Because, I mean, it seems like almost everyone goes through it, right? Mm. And the fact that most people don't even know what it is that they're going through, I think that should be scary to most people.
Mm. Yeah. I wonder how student bodies address this question today, specifically that now we have a better knowledge and awareness on mental health. I wonder if they now have maybe group discussions around, you know, specific subjects that might bring stress instead of, yeah, to maybe also benefit from alumni and you know, those kind of peer support as well could be very helpful. I don't know. Maybe you could tell me, but I think this is something that could also be very helpful.
Yeah, I think, first of all, just, you know, being able to identify that, you know, this is a problem and it exists and we have a lot of people who are going through it. I think that could be a starting point, right? Mm-hmm. So people could actually put a name to what they're going through, right? I think that could be a starting point. And then, you know, set up facilities that could help these people because they need help. Even if they don't know they need help, they actually need help.
Yeah, really, making sure that you don't normalize the fact of feeling very low. It shouldn't be a normal.
It should be normal. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. It shouldn't be a normal at all. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And so, I mean, I'm a college student, right? So I have a lot of friends who are college students too. Do you think now we should probably have something called midlife? I mean, well, we have midlife crisis, right? Do you think we should have something like quarter life crisis? Because people are confused out there.
And what do you mean?
I mean, you know, probably problems and challenges that people are supposed to be going through when they're, I don't know, like 40, 45 years old, they are going through those problems right now.
You've reached this life, but you're looking back and saying, does this really fit who I am, or does this really fit who I want to be? So this identity crisis of, okay, maybe I need to make some changes, and this is where you do flamboyant things. But I see. So same thing, you've gone through a golden period, and then you've reached that level where, okay, now you're on your own.
Exactly.
And you're like, but is this really who I want to be? Is this really who I am?
Or has my life been a lie?
Has my life been a lie? Yes, and it can bring a lot of anxiety, I guess, and those strong questions and maybe guilt as well, all of that. So how do you deal with it?
Yeah,
is a question.
Yeah. How do you deal with it?
Mm-hmm. You try things.
At some point, people are even afraid. Like, do I really have enough time to try things? Right? They're still young. Mm-hmm. They do have time, but then they go like, "Yeah, I don't think I have enough time to try."
Really?
Right now I need to have things figured out. And I think that's also where most people kind of overthink things. They're like, well, my friends have their life figured out. I don't even know what I want to do. Like I'm so lost, I'm confused, and they're in Lost City.
I think it's a big I don't think so. I don't think people have their lives figured out even at older ages. At
after college, I wouldn't assume a bit that you have your life figured out. Actually, you have some tools. You have some tools that you honed or that were given to you so that you can try out what you're about in life and then this see what works for you. You have some tools. That's all you have, I would say. But I would be very surprised to hear someone who has their lives figured out at that young age.
Early 20s.
No, it's very early and I think it's also part of the beauty of life is to really try to find out who you are and you know, you might think you know who you are, but in new situation you'll discover something different from you. It's about discovering, being open to what life has for you and new experiences and life in general.
Yeah, and I mean, the best way to know who you are is to actually put yourself in the middle of chaos, right? Because most of the times when you're relaxed, for example, you might go like, you know what? I don't have anger issues, right? And then when you have conversations with people who don't agree with any bit of what you're saying, then now you go like, this is interesting, right?
That is interesting.
And then you'll still say you don't have, you know, anger issues. And so I think now we are being exposed to that situation.
Yeah.
In the early 20s, it's like, cool. My life is not figured out. I don't know if I'm going to get a job or not when I graduate. I don't know if I want to have a family. And then, you know, you have the whole society behind you saying, you know what? Cool. Now you're done studying. We're waiting to see what you're going to be doing. Right. So I think the fact that you're being exposed to that type of situation makes us really kind of like, it's an opportunity for us to really figure out who we are.
Yeah. And what you're saying also makes me think also that question is also related to a question of, are you connected with who you are? Are you connected with your feelings, how you feel? Because as you say, when we go and study, it's about what we do. It's not about how we feel or how we are within or how we connected with what we want. So that identity crisis is also a crisis because you feel that something somewhere you're not connected with or to. So are you connected? Or can you find ways to stay more connected? Because I feel having life figured out, I think to me means I'm connected. I'm in line with what I feel. I'm in line. I'm not disconnected. I'm not basing myself on what other people think or what a society should. So I'm in line with that, I think. And sometimes I think the education system sometimes works on disconnecting you or doesn't work on making sure that you're in line with, when you're talking about sense of burnout, when we're going through burnout, it's also because we're disconnecting ourselves from our needs. When we're talking about the reasons why people are coming in, it's because there's a sense of disconnection, you know, of they've tried to disconnect from the pain that they were feeling, but now somehow it's overwhelming because the pain asks, you know, to be addressed, and it needs to be addressed and healed in a way. So the importance of connection, I think once you're connected, I don't know if it makes any sense what I'm saying, but once you feel good and in line with, you know, and with who you are, then the rest becomes easier, I would say.
And is it that, you know, when you are almost graduating college, that's when you start thinking about it simply because All that other time, you really don't have an opportunity to be able to think about such things.
I think maybe during college, you can feed on other people's feedback and praises and expectations and things like that. And you feel like you're ticking all the boxes. But maybe at the end of it, you might be left to your own self.
You're on your own.
You're on your own. And the praising and thing does... It's waiting on you now. You're the one who has to jump, but now if you feel like, but is this really what I wanted to do? Is this really me? If you have those voices no longer very close or nearby. Yeah.
And then there's also the peer pressure.
And
And a lot of people can't handle it.
Mm.
It's a huge problem for them. So, well, all my friends are now doing an internship. I need to get an internship.
Mm.
All my friends have secured a job. Well, I need to secure a job. And in case that's not the case for you, you're not able to do that, then it's also a problem.
Yeah. Yeah. So it's important to see, why is it a problem? Is it the problem because you're no longer part of the group? Or is it the problem because, for other reasons, maybe you need that internship for you to access this and this and that. Mm. Is it a problem that you're not getting it now? Why is it a problem that you're not getting it now? Like, can it wait? Can you know, a couple of months? Why? It's important to address that as well, and to try to find a reasonable answer to it. So to address the fears, the unconscious fears that are raised. Maybe if you're not like the others, maybe you feel that the others are going to judge you as less, and that's important to you.
Which goes back to our childhood experience.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
Yeah, I know, because I think, you know, if you are raised to be, what's the word? More of like, well, you don't need to seek external approval from people, right? Because what's the word, you know, like when you're, you know, you don't need external validation.
Confident?
No, not confident really. But yeah, I mean, so when you don't need people to validate you, or you don't need people to tell you that, you know what, you're good at this, for you to feel you're actually good at it. And so that's where the whole sense of, you know, when you speak about wanting to be part of a group, so sense of belonging, and then external validation, maybe for some it's just external validation, right? That, well, I'm good at what I'm doing, so, you know, I could land a job or that kind of stuff. I mean it fascinates me big time what our childhood experiences can reveal about ourselves. And most of the times I really like asking people about their childhood experiences, because in a way it tells me a lot more than what they can actually tell me right now, or more than what they might want me to see, or even more than what they actually know about themselves.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I think most people should actually look back into their childhood stories.
Yeah. And maybe also be compassionate to the child they were.
Yeah, probably. And I think what's sad is the fact that those formative years are so crucial to your life. And when you are young, when you are that stage, when you are the kid, you have no idea. Mm. Like, you don't know about it at all. Mm. I think it's a bit unfair.
You have no idea. And also because you feel like what is happening is the truth, I think. If someone tells you you're a bad kid, you're going to believe them, specifically if you like the person.
Yeah.
And you won't challenge it because you love the person. And then you're going to grow up like, you're an ugly person. You're going to grow up like that with that sense. And not unless you confront it later on. And then where did it come from, actually? And it's, I realize, but that person told that to me and I believed it.
And it's crazy.
Or you're dumb. Or you're stupid. You can't amount to nothing. Mm.
And it takes a lot of energy for you to be able to fight that.
Mm.
Or recover from that.
Mm.
After you've grown up. I mean, and because people who... So the adults that young people associate with, you know, when they're kids, they have a huge influence on these young people, right? Mm-hmm. And these young people don't really know about it, right? So if someone says, you know, you can't amount to anything, you actually believe in, right? And you live your life believing that. So bad. What type of a child were you growing up?
Am I in therapy? I think I was a dreamy child. I mean, I dreamed a lot. I always wanted to have sheep, and I growing up I did have some sheep, so I were able to make. Yeah, I think I was lucky enough to grow up in a good environment, and with a mom who really believed in me, and parents as well in general. Yeah.
Did you ever want to be a clinical psychologist, or that changed along the way?
I knew that in secondary school. Before I wanted to be a farmer.
With the sheep. You wanted... Why a farmer with the sheep?
I don't know, somehow. Something about the sheep.
You like them?
Yeah, I like them. I like the contact with nature. I like the white spaces. I like the those kind of things. I like...
So what changed your mind? I mean, did you have many ships and they're like, okay, cool, now I'm done with ships? And
I guess I was able to do both at one point. But having ships in town is a bit difficult.
Yeah, that's true. But then why clinical psychologist?
I found it fascinating how, I think the same way as you did, I find it fascinating how the mind can also shape someone's response to something happening to them, the resilience. And also what can move someone to do terrible acts. And I needed to understand that. When I was in secondary school, it was after the genocide that was perpetrated here and against the Tutsis. And I wanted to really understand in order for me to get a better grip on what it means to be human, what it means, you know, in terms of humanity, with, you know, the emotions, the impact of emotions.
Mm.
I think emotions have a very, very important role in our lives. It can be ferment. In French, they say ferment, but you know, the ingredient that you can put in bread so that it rises.
Mm.
Or in yogurt so that it gels.
Yeah. Isn't that? It was there.
It's yeast.
Yeast.
It can be. I think emotions are really important yeast component of someone's life and strength and energy and all of that. I think it's very, very key, more than knowledge. I've always been interested in. I think this is where also I joined the studies, is like, what are the yeasts that you give your children at the very beginning so that, you know, their bread rises as they grow up? It's based on which yeast? Is it based on courage, love, hopefulness, wonder of what the world has to offer? Or is it based on something else? Whatever it is, it's going to make the bread rise in a certain way.
And those are really intense questions for a secondary school kid.
Mm, mm.
Why were you thinking those questions during that time? I mean, is there anything that made you start thinking about them?
Mm. Yeah, I think... I think, as I said, we were going through... the country was going through a very troubled time, and...
Speaking about the Rwandan genocide.
Yes, the genocide against the Tutsis here, it was the incapacity of understanding. You know, when we heard bombs and fires here, I remember feeling very old. Because I, in my little head at the time, I thought I used to hear about World One, World Two, and these were things for grandmothers. And somehow I made the connection that now I was also, in a way, in the same category as my grandmothers who went through the same thing. Because I thought, or the way it's being taught in the school is that, you know, there were wars and then there were agreements and then now, you know, peace. And it seemed to me like it's something that are things that should be resolved by adults. And, you know, I'm trying to understand about the why and the why of many, many things, the why of the fears, why is it this way? And then afterwards, how can people commit such things? What brought them there? And yeah.
It's an intense experience.
Mm-hmm.
So how did the experience affect you?
I think even in ways that you don't even realize. I think it's not me, it's everyone here. And even for generations to come, it's going to affect them or even is here in ways that we don't realize that it's affecting us. I wouldn't even be able to tell. But I think just the understanding of the world and what is possible and what is necessary to build for something to happen and not to happen is these were important questions that that stayed in, on my mind, I'm sure in a lot of people's mind afterwards. And the realization also, you know, of how things were built after that, you know, talking about yeast, what were the yeast that were necessary for this country to be rebuilt in such a short amount of time with such a vision of wanting to be hopeful, to offer the best to the next generations? What are the yeast that were there? For me, these are important questions. I see emotions almost like atoms of our human beings, mental beings. Emotions are almost like the atoms of, you know, everything that are going to be structured around.
But isn't it scary the extent of what humans can do?
And
especially with this particular experience. I mean, both the good and the bad things.
Yeah. Of course it's scary.
Mm-hmm. You said, you know, one of the questions was, you know, thinking as to why people would be able to do such things. Mm-hmm. I mean, did you find answers to that?
Well, what struck me, for me, from what I understood, is it doesn't happen in a go. In my understanding, it took about 3 generations to have that full-on total genocide to be able to happen. And it took 3 generations also at school of education, early childhood education of pitting people against each other, of desensitizing children to the pain of others, of desensitizing parents to the pains of others. And it's not something that you can do on such a large scale in one generation. I think it takes 2 or 3 generations to happen. I think unless you have strong beacons in your mind that can help you counter that, it's easy if you're surrounded by those kind of structures, it's easy to put someone into that mindset after 3 generations, I feel.
For our listeners who, you know, don't understand, you know, the history of the genocide against the Tutsi in Rwanda, do you mind briefing them a little bit about it?
You're putting now it's a history lesson.
No, just very briefly, so they can understand the extent of the experience that you had gone through during that time.
Mm-hmm. So in 1994, from April, 400 days, we had the onset of a genocide that would claim over a million lives of people in 100 days. And just based on the what they call the ethnicity of the people, an ethnicity that was fixed during the colonial times based on ideology of the colonial structures at the time. And so I think also one of the particularity here in Rwanda is, as opposed to other genocides, is that it was stopped by other Rwandans. It wasn't stopped by foreign powers. Actually, the foreign powers left people to their own fatal destinies. When they had the chance to do something about it, and the UN was here and they left. So that of course, was not what I'm saying about the three generation. That was something that was extremely well prepared. People had lists of names of people that needed to be killed, down to the children. People knew where to put barrages, blockades. People had been furnished with weapons. They were grouped into, you know, different leaders that would commit, and then they would need to report on the people who were killed. So it was extremely efficient. And prior to that, there were trainings. Prior to that, there had been sensitization within the schools of children that grew up to become the killers later on. There were sensitizations within churches. There was, so it was an ambience of things. And before that, there were even structural measures that had been taken in terms of the number of Tutsis, for example, who were allowed to go study at universities beyond secondary school, things like that, or to have even access to certain positions, certainly not at the government level. So, and we had a lot of people who had been pushed away and had to leave the country starting in 59, already where the massacres had already started happening. But what I believe really is that those kind of power structures that push one group to vilify another is really a power structure that is looking for their own power and to try to justify their incapacity to bring a better life to their people by just finding a scapegoat group and finding a group that can be used to justify this lack of opportunity, lack of everything. Because, you know, in so many years, and if you look at this so little few years, what was able to happen here just because of the will of, you know, the power in place to make something out of this country for their people. The difference is striking.
Yeah, the difference is striking. Yeah, I mean, it was a horrible experience. It was. And I mean, and I think, well, that was, you know, okay, this is the scariest things that humans can do to each other. And then after that, I think people got to learn the other side of things. It's like, well, in as much as, you know, this is how, you know, this is the extent of what people can do to hurt others. And then the extent of, you know, now that, you know, trying to rebuild after that. I mean, I think it shows that humans are capable of a lot of things.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, good things included.
Mm-hmm. And I think, and now we're going into a very different discussion, but I think also what is very painful is not only there's the perpetrator, there's the victim, but there's also the people who are looking and not doing anything. In many cases, even in abuse and things like that, you know, what can be even more hurtful is the fact that you notice that no one was, the people who were watching and not doing anything or not saying anything.
And they had the power to do something.
Could have the power to do something.
Yeah. And well, so why do you think the people who could do something about it will just sit aside and watch?
You'll have to ask them, but I think in terms of if we scale it down to something that can happen to you and me, I don't know what would your hypothesis be?
I don't know. Maybe some of them wouldn't just want to take sides. They wouldn't want to be affiliated with any sides, but that's still bad, right? Because, I mean, if you could bring both parties to peace, then you'll have done a better job rather than just sitting aside and maybe thinking that I don't want to be affiliated with any of the groups.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I think, you know, geopolitics is something that is also a different beast in itself. I think you have also vested interests in many things. With a disconnect to what it means at a human level. So maybe there's a famous leader who said, you know, something that a genocide in Africa means nothing, or something like that, and or the simple fact that at the UN level they were resisting calling it a genocide because it would mean their obligation as a UN body to intervene, and so those kind of vested interests, what would it mean?
That in a way tells you who your friends are, right? Because I think most of the times we usually like to think a lot of people are friends, right? But then when we get into adversity, then that's when you really know who your friend is, because most people usually run away from you. Humans are interesting. They're weird creatures. And it's absolutely fascinating to kind of like understand what motivates people. Have you seen the movie The Mindhunter? Well, I don't know if you're a movie person. Okay, it's a series, right? It's a series, and basically what they're trying to do, they're trying to see or get into the mind of criminals, right? So these are criminals who have been arrested, and then they would go over and kind of like interview them and have conversations with them. And it's fascinating because almost all of them, right, the experience has been, I did what I did because of the experience I had with my mom or with my dad when I was a kid, right? And so they would use those to justify, you know, what they were doing or the type of people they became. And still back throughout our whole conversation, it's like, well, you know, childhood experiences or childhood trauma in a huge way caused them to become serial killers without them really, because when you sit down and speak with them, that's when they also figure out that, you know what, I think I did this because this is how my parents raised me, or this is what my parents told me, and in a way it influenced, you know, who I became and what I did.
And at the same time, we need to be careful and not say that everyone who goes through traumatic event is going to be
absolutely, we're not saying that at all. We're not saying that at all. It's just that most of the people, it affects how they grow, right? It affects the type of people they become. And unfortunately, most people don't know that their childhood experience is what makes them behave this in ways that they behave, right? Obviously, some people realize it, right? They go like, cool, you know, this is the experience I had, this is how I grew up, and then they do something about it, right? So for example, I know I have anger issues. Very little things piss me off, right? And the moment I realize that, it's like, okay, cool, so this is a problem, how do I start dealing with it, right? So sometimes it could be mechanisms that, you know, you just put in place so you can protect yourself, or just shut down completely, so you remove yourself from that situation. But then it's like, how many people, you know, are able to look back into the people they were and the people they want to become and say, okay, cool, this is who I was, this is who I am, and this is the gap that I need to close down. So I agree with you. Yeah, not everybody becomes a bad person.
Yeah. And I think anger is really an interesting topic because, as you said, I think anger is also a way to really protect your boundaries when your boundaries are being, you know, invaded and you feel like, you know, you're being threatened in a way, and you push people like, no, this is not okay. And you express that boundary really clearly. But then when we talk about anger issues, as you say, sometimes it's really related to something deeper. And from way back. And
exactly.
Something that, you know, it's triggering about something, and then it brings you back, and the stronger, that excessive force actually is not specifically on that event, but it's because it's related to something else as well.
Obviously, at certain times you have to put up mechanisms to, you know, stop that. I've never thought of it as people invading, you know, certain aspects of your life or your boundaries. But, well, it's interesting to think about it. Yeah, it's interesting to think about it. Because, I mean, you didn't obviously want people to do that, to invade your boundaries or your privacy or whatever it is. So.
Yeah. And then when you repress your anger, when you think about it, and you're not able to put those boundaries and you repress it, it also brings another set of pain and discomfort. Because then you feel like people are in your space and are not respecting your space, but you're unable to put those boundaries clearly and express them as well.
The problem is that most of the times the solutions that we put up in place, they're just for the situation, right? So if I think now invading my privacy, or, you know, getting into aspects that I wouldn't want you to, and then I go like, cool, maybe my mechanism is just, I just shut down, I just keep quiet, I don't talk, right? I think in a way it's, I don't think it's a long-lasting solution, right?
But in a way, it's another way of putting that distance.
Yeah, that's true.
Or put the distance with the whatever is triggering you. It's like really you're putting a barrier of silence, but it's still a barrier.
No. Have you watched The Angry Birds? Okay, you're not a movie person. Huh. No. You haven't watched it. Anyways, it's cool because they have a lot of stuff about anger and anger management classes.
Mm-hmm.
What do they do in anger management classes? If you know.
But I think what we would work in with anger is really to look at the source of it. When it's something that is healthy, it's something that's happening to you at that moment from that event, then you have that anger rising. And it's a healthy response, I would say, right? It doesn't mean you need to scream on top of your lungs. You can express your angers in very different ways. Yeah. You don't need specifically to scream. But having that anger and expressing that anger to help you keep those boundaries safe can be is a healthy response. But if you have you feel like you're always on the brink of bursting, or you feel like you're very extra sensitive to something, or you feel like in retrospect, the amplitude of response was not fitting the element, it's worth digging a bit of where it comes from. As it might be, you know, that sense of, I don't know, just hypothetically, maybe you feel like hugely disrespected by what was said or what was done, or I don't know, maybe, I don't know, they didn't give you the spot of for your car, and you feel like, what disrespect, why, and maybe there was no other space for you to park, just that. There's no ill intent, but maybe it can be linked to really a sense of insecurity related to feeling disrespected. Maybe you were disrespected at a very tender or vulnerable age, and you don't want that to ever happen again. And you're making sure in all ways possible that it doesn't happen, or at least it brings you back in a heartbeat to that moment, and then you have that strong response. I don't know. This can be one of the reasons.
Mm-hmm. So still you have to go back and look at yourself, and
if you want to change,
read yourself,
understand where it comes from.
Let's assume someone is listening to this podcast, if any, and maybe they've had a childhood experience that wasn't a good one, right? What are the steps that they should probably start taking right now to?
Mm-hmm. First of all, we all have experiences that weren't good ones, right?
That's true.
We have good and bad ones. It's what forms us. Yeah. It's what helps us deal and build also coping mechanisms. I think what you're referring to is those experiences that left you really hopeless and overwhelmed and alone in a way, in dealing with it, and in a way that didn't give you some form of closure or made you seek coping mechanisms that were not helpful to you in the long run. In that case, and if you come to that realization, find someone you trust. Maybe if you don't have maybe find someone you trust, you can start talking about this with. And if you have the opportunity to seek out for, and the willingness to seek out for professional help, also do that. Try it out. Might be something that can help you as well.
Thank you for the session.
Thank you too. It was nice.